Good morning. I will speak about Arakelov theory. So today I will essentially make an introduction to this topic. So I will remind you a few notions which are of use in Arakelov theory. So we are concerned by a scheme X over Z, separated finite type flat over Z. And since we want to do differential geometry on the complex point of X, we shall assume that the set of complex points, S of C, is a smooth analytic manifold. So we assume that the generic fiber is smooth. So under this hypothesis, we talk about Hermitian line bundles on X. So definition, an Hermitian line bundle over X is a pair L bar equals LH, where L is a line bundle on X, an algebraic line bundle on X. In other words, an invertible OX module. And second, H is a smooth metric on the complex line bundle LC induced by L on XC. So it's a metric. So for each stalk, we have a notion of norms. And this norm varies in smoothly in local coordinates. We had some little condition, which is that the metric is invariant under some involution the complex conjugation on XC. We can conjugate the coordinate of complex points. This is an anti-holomorphic isomorphism. And we can apply this anti-holomorphic isomorphism to LC. And the condition is that the norm is invariant under this involution. So this will be our object of study, Hermitian line models on arithmetic varieties. Let's say when I say arithmetic variety, I mean essentially this data. Okay, let me give some examples. So let's call D the Krull dimension of X. And we discuss example according to the dimension. So first, D equals 1. F is a number field. S is a spectrum of the ring of integers in F. And assume we consider the complex embedding of F, complex embedding of this number field, called it phi. So L bar is an Hermitian Lie model on X. So X on S. So S has dimension 1. We consider an Hermitian Lie model on S. This means that we have a rank 1 OF module, and we have a metric on all the lines spanned by this line model on the C. Well, in that case, we have an interesting notion, namely, the arithmetic degree of L bar is a number. So we say degree hat for Arakelov, say degree L bar is the following number. So we choose S, a non-zero element in L. And we look at the following. First, we look at L divided by the line model spanned by S. So this is just a finite group. So we can take the cardinality of this finite group and log of this cardinality. So this is one part of the degree. We subtract from this for all complex embedding, log of the norm of S, maybe we call it norm of sigma S. So S is a section of L, so it gives a section on LC for any complex embedding, and we have this norm, so we subtract log of the norm. So this looks like it depends on S. In fact, it does not. It does not depend on S. This is by the product formula. If you change from S to S prime will be the multiple of S by some function, and the degree of this function will be zero by the product formula. So the degree enjoys nice properties, namely, it's additive. The degree of the tensor product of L1 with L2 is the degree of L1 plus the degree of L2. So we can extend this definition to higher rank bundles. So if E is a Hermitian vector bundle on S. That is, E now is not assumed to be rank 1, it can be higher rank. So assume we have an Hermitian vector bundle on S. We can define the degree of this pair as the degree of the Lie module, which is the determinant. So lambda n e, lambda n h. Where n is the rank of E. So this is for the case D equals 1. We have an interesting invariant of Hermitian Lie modules. Now we consider the case D equals 2. So we have what's called an arithmetic surface, a dimension 2 arithmetic variety. So this is really where Arakelov theory starts, with arithmetic surfaces. So assume we have an arithmetic surface. And let me assume that X is proper on space Z. Of projective arithmetic variety, say. So it's flat and proper. And we assume that the relative dimension is 1. So the dimension in the fibers is 1. The base spec G is dimension 1. So the dimension of the scheme X is 2. So we say that X is an arithmetic surface. So we can make a drawing. We have X of dimension 2. The base is spec Z. And we have a map of definition of X. And for every prime, so any point, any close point in spec Z, we have the fiber, which in general will be a nice smooth curve over FP. But for finitely many Q, for finitely many primes in spec Z, the fiber can be more complicated, maybe it can be singular. And even it can be non-reduced. So there are singularities to take care of at finite spaces. So this is the scheme part of the story. And now we are interested in the complex points. So the complex points here is a Riemann surface. So think of it as a vertical Riemann surface. And think of it as a the fiber at infinity of the arithmetic surface. And this is a picture. This is X of C. So we think of this picture as some compactification of X. X was not compact because the base is affine. But the idea is that complex points is some kind of compactification. one does not try to mix the topology here and here. One just puts the fiber at infinity here to remember the construction one wants to do. Okay. So what is the main invariant in dimension 2? It's called arithmetic intersection. Given L bar and M bar, two Hermitian line bundles on X, the arithmetic surface, Arakelov, and later on the line, define a real number L bar dot M bar which is called the arithmetic intersection number of L bar and M bar. If I have two Hermitian line bundles on some arithmetic surface, I have a real number which is some intersection. So I shall give a definition. First, I will give a few properties of this number. First, it is multiplicative, so L bar tensor L2 bar dot M bar is the same as L1 bar dot M bar plus L2 bar dot M bar. Second, it's symmetric, L bar M bar is M bar L bar. And let me say right away that it depends on the matrix. It's not independent of the matrix as usual in topology, say, but it depends on the matrix we have chosen. So for instance, assume I have a line bundle with a metric H. I consider another line bundle L prime with the same underlying line bundle L and with multiplication of the metric by the exponential of a real number. So I multiply the scalar product by a constant. Then we have the following. L prime bar M bar is equal to L bar M bar minus T over 2, the degree of M. So the intersection of M bar with the line bundle L bar, we change the metric, differs by T degree of M. Excuse me? What's the question?
Degree of M bar.
Degree hat of M bar or degree of M? Degree of M like
so it's degree of M. Is it the
degree is even in dimension 1 or dimension 2?
So degree of M is the degree of the restriction of M to the complex curve, Xi. So this is an algebraic notion, but it comes in by multiplying T by this degree. Okay, so now we shall define this number. So I say we can assume that X is regular. So to define L bar M bar, we can assume that X is regular. Indeed, we know that there exists a decentralization of X. Where pi is an isomorphism from X tilde minus the bad fibers. Or the singularities. So we take X minus the singular part of X, call it U, and I can restrict pi to U, to pi minus 1 U, which is the dense open subset in X tilde. So the situation is almost the same in X tilde and X, except for a closed subset. So we just say the following, L bar M bar is by definition pi upper star of L bar intersection pi upper star of M bar. If X is not regular, we take the intersection on the resolution of X. And we have to show, after defining this number, that it does not depend on pi. But
regular, is the same as smooth?
What?
Regular and smooth.
Very different. So smooth is regular over a field. And here, so for instance, we can, I mean, if we think of the map of definition of X, it's not smooth because some fibers are singular. But we could very well have the situation where X is regular, but the fiber will still have singularities. So smooth is a relative notion and regular an absolute one. Excuse me?
Do we assume X to be normal?
I think it's something I want, yes. I think I want X to be normal. So maybe I should put it at the beginning. Yes. So I assume that X is normal. Okay. Now let me define L bar M bar when X is regular. Now that X is regular, to give L or to give a section of L and the corresponding divisor is an equivalence. So I could consider the intersection of two divisors, and by linearity, that is property one, I think, I could assume that this divisor is irreducible. So So we can assume that L is O of D, L prime, M is O of E, D and E being irreducible divisors. So I will distinguish two cases. First case, D is vertical. When I say that D is vertical, it really means that D is vertical in this picture. So this image in spec Z is a point. A finite field. So f of d is the ideal span by a prime, and we consider the inclusion d of d in x. And then we make the following definition, L bar M bar equals the degree on D of the restriction of M times log of pi. So it does not depend on the metric. In that case, when this vertical, we just restrict the other line bundle to D and take its degree. No role for the intersection as soon as one of them is vertical. Now assume D and E are horizontal. And disjoint. I mean, you could have the situation where D goes E, but then by changing the divisor representing M, we go to another divisor which meets properly with D. So to give a definition, we can assume that D and E are disjoint. Then we have the following picture. So we have X. We have D. And we have E. And D and E meet in the finite places. They meet here. And here. And what we shall see is that we have to consider that D and E meets at infinity. Somehow E and D can try to be parallel, but they have to meet at infinity. So we define the intersection as follows. Well, first, if x is a point in x, a closed point, we let Ox be the local ring of x at x, and we have d, which is the divisor of a section of L, and E, which is the divisor of a section of M. We can restrict this section at the point X. So we have ST, which is the ideal in OX span by S and T. I mean the restriction to an infinitesimal neighborhood of small x.
Are the divisor effective?
Yes, I can assume D and E are effective because by additivity, all I need to define is DE when D and E are effective irreducible. Yes. Thank you. So then I can consider the following thing. The ring OX divided by the ideal span by S and T. And this happens to be a finite ring. So L bar M bar will have two terms, an algebraic part and an analytic part. The algebraic part will be the sum for all closed point X of the log of the cardinality of OX divided by the ideal span by S and D. But as before, I have to add some counterpart at infinity so that it does not depend on choices. And for this, I will introduce some notation. So XC is a Riemann surface, so it's a complex manifold. And I can consider APQ of XC, which is a vector space of forms, infinite forms of type PQ. Second, the derivative d equals d plus d bar, where d is anti-holomorphic and d bar is holomorphic, going from APQ to APQ plus 1.
D is holomorphic and d bar entire. You
say
the opposite.
No. OK. So I mean that this one goes from APQ to AP plus 1 Q, and this one goes to APQ to APQ plus 1. So I don't know. Which is called what? Okay, so we'll be talking about DDC, which is the same as minus DD bar over 2 pi I. So DC is a real operator, which is D minus D bar over 4 pi I. Okay, so these are classical complex geometry notion. And we have a metric on the line bundle L and the line bundle M. So let L bar C be the complex line bundle L C with the metric H. So if S is a section, holomorphic section of LC, we have a notion of norms, which is the same as the scalar product of S with itself. Definition. The first transform C1 of L bar C, which is a class in A11 of XC, is the form such that, well, we might have trouble with the singularities of S, the place where S is zero. So we look outside the place where S is zero, and we have the equation defining the first transform, C1 L bar C equals minus DDC log of S squared. So this is an equality of forms on XC minus the divisor of S. So there is a 1-1 form defined by L and its metric, which is the first transform, and the cohomology class of this first transform is the first transform class of L. Okay, now I can define the second part. Well, except I have to do a little more. I have to give a name to these points here and here. So the restriction to complex point of D is by notation sum of n alpha p alpha, and EC is a sum of a beta m beta q beta. So here we have q, here we have p. So they are disjoint by the hypothesis. They are disjoint, but still they repel each other. There is a notion of electrostatic on the Riemann surface. There is a repulsion force between the devices. So this is counted in the intersection formula, namely I take minus sum of a beta of m beta log of the norm of S on q beta. So q beta has to do with t, and we take the sum of the evaluation of S at the point of the divisor of t. That's the first term. And second, we take an integral, namely integral of xc of c1 of L bar c, which I defined before, multiplied by log t. So the formula is quite complicated compared to the vertical case. there is intersection at finite places, and at infinity there is a combination of logarithm and transforms. So the statement is that this pairing is well defined, so it does not depend on the choice of S and T. It's symmetric, it does not look so because we have C1 log T and log S here, but we can apply the Stokes formula to DDC. And we have to be careful because we have log singularities when applying Stokes. So we have to take small open neighborhood around the point P alpha and Q beta and apply the Stokes formula there, and then tend the radius of the disk around the point to zero. This way you prove that it is symmetric and it's bilinear. And the property that I said, that if L is replaced by L with a metric being multiplicable constant, this constant will appear here, and then we'll have sum of m beta, so we'll have the degree of m coming in, so we'll have something like minus sum m beta log t, a t, because I took h goes to h into the t. So we get the degree times t with a 1/2 somewhere, and that's the way you prove the third property just from the formula. Okay, so this is the intersection. We shall use it to formulate some conjectures in Arakelov theory. And before I go to these conjectures, I have still one notion I want to introduce, which is due to the line. Namely, we have a notion of pairing. So assume I have x and y, two arithmetic varieties. Assume I have a map F from X to Y, where F is proper and flat. And F restricted to the complex point of X is smooth. So we assume that the relative dimension, the dimensions of the fibers, is 1. In other words, we have a family of curves over Y.
But the dimension of X and Y can be of Y can be arbitrary.
They can be 5 or 5 and 6, or they can be arbitrary. Yes. Yes, the relative dimension is 1, but x and y are higher dimensional. Over spec z. So given L bar and M bar, two Hermitian line models on x, the line defined an Hermitian Lie model on Y. An Hermitian Lie model denoted L bar M bar on the variety Y. So this pairing is symmetric bilinear and it depends on the metric on L and M, but it's related to the pairing we said before, namely assume Y is spec over F. So now the base is dimension 1 and the fibers are dimension 1. It's a family of curves on the ring of integers OF. Then we can consider the Hermitian line model defined by the line. So it's an Hermitian line model on S. We can take its degree and we recover the intersection of L and M. So the intersection as a number is a special case of the intersection of the pairing of the line with two. Again, given two L bundle, two line bundle L and M on X, define a line bundle LM on Y. So we shall need this notion a little in the second lecture. So I will stop here before going to conjectures. So now we talk about conjectures. And there is an excellent reference for conjectures, which is an article by Moret-Bailly. Which is called Auteur et classe de Chern. Sur les surfaces arithmétiques. C'est un article qui est apparu dans l'astérisque numéro 183 à la page 37 jusqu'à 58. Alors c'est un astérisque qui a été coordonné par Spiro sur la conjecture de Mandel. Et Moret-Bailly a dedans clarifié des conjectures de Parshin dans le cas qu'on va voir. Oui, je sais. So, you understood nothing. I will repeat. Okay, so the situation we shall look at is slightly different from before. Maybe we shall take a number field look at S the spectrum of the integers in F. And we shall assume that x from f to s, so this map f, is a semi-stable curve. So let me explain what it means. Well, there are several notions when considering a curve of a number field. The first notion is nodal curve. So if f from x to s proper is proper and flat, surjective of relative dimension 1, so it's family of curve on S, we say that it is an ordered curve if when for every algebraic point the fiber which I will denote by x index k bar, so now it's a curve on the algebraic closed field k bar, I'm asking that this fiber has only double point singularities. Ordinary double point singularities. What is the question? Thank you very much. Yeah, so I have f to s, spec k bar goes to s, and we consider the fiber product x k bar over spec k. We ask that we have only ordinary double point singularities, which means that in local coordinate, this is just the singularity xy equals 0. So this is the first notion, nodal curve. The second notion is semi-stable. Semi-stable curve is an ordered curve such that for any spec k bar to s as above, x k bar is connected the arithmetic genus of x k bar is at least 1, and any component c of x k bar, which is isomorphic to p1 of a k bar, has at least 2 singularities. The last notion is a notion of stable curves. Well, it's a special case of semi-stable curve. So we have the same notion, except that the arithmetic genus of SK bar is at least two. And any C, any component C isomorphic P1 over K bar, has at least three singularities. Okay, so we shall assume that X over S is semi-stable. Then there is a very interesting Lie model on X. Omega, which is called the relative dualizing sheaf, which can be characterized as follows. Assume omega is restricted to x minus the double points. So we have singularities here. Well, first there is no double line because X is semi-stable. Second, the singularities are points, ordinary double points, in the fiber and here. If I restrict omega to X minus double points, I restrict to some scheme which is smooth on the base. There is no singularity anymore. So omega on X minus double point is the same as differential, so I call this U, of U over S. So this is a characterization of omega in the sense that if there exists a Lie model equal to omega 1 outside these points, it's unique because these points have codimension 2. So I'm not giving you the definition of omega, but I am giving you an argument which for the characterization of omega. Okay. Regular? What? Regular? Semi-stable. As the generic fiber is smooth, and no, but I see your point. No, I'm taking... Ça marche, quoi.
You may assume regular, because after some extension...
We can always assume regular, because the largest semi-stable curve is a regular scheme. So we can assume regular, but I think we don't need to.
Omega is a dualizing sheaf?
Yes. So this is a Lie model of interest on X. And Arakelov has defined a metric on omega. So omega on the complex point is of course just the differential on the Riemann surface. And Arakelov has defined a metric on this line model. So I will explain the metric. It's a little long, but it's nice. So let M be a Riemann surface. Of genus G positive. So in the construction of Arakelov, we assume that the generic fiber has a positive genus. We exclude the case of P1. Assume alpha and beta are two global differentials on M. We define their intersection product as I over 2 integral on M alpha wedge beta bar. So this is the definition of a scalar product on the differentials. The differential form a vector space of dimension G. So we can consider alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha g, an orthonormal basis of omega 1 m. And Arakelov introduces the following one form. I over 2g sum j equals 1 to g omega j wedge omega j bar. So notice that the integral on m of mu is equal to 1. Question? Alpha, thank you. So if we integrate this form on M, we get the self-intersection of alpha with itself, which is 1 because it's orthonormal. So I get G I over 2, and this is exactly because of this I over 2, this is equal to 1. Okay. Now once we have chosen this canonical 1-1 form on M, we can define Green functions. So if P is a point in M, we define a function GP, which is an L1 function on M. L1 function is like a distribution, and so GP will be characterized by the following condition. If I consider DGC of GP so I think of GP as a distribution on M, therefore I can take the derivative of this distribution, DGC of GP plus the current given by integration on P, by taking value at P, and I ask that this is equal to mu. This is one condition. The second condition is the normalization of GP, integral M GP times mu is equal to 0. So the existence of GP is by the D bar lemma, and this condition, I mean, if you have this condition, the first condition, then GP is known up to a constant, and the constant gets fixed by the second condition. So GP is well defined. We define a function in two variables, GPQ, simply by saying that GPQ is GP of Q, if P is different from Q. Consider the diagonal in M cross M. So the next claim is that there exists a metric on O of the diagonal. So it's a line model on M cross M. And there exists a metric such that if I consider minus log of the norm of the canonical section of O delta square. So I'm defining this two bar here, the metric on O delta. And the log of the norm is GPQ. In fact, you can prove that GPQ is the same as GQP. So we get a metric. I mean, along the diagonal, there is a logarithmic singularities. So this norm here gets like log of the distance to the diagonal. And GPQ also has a logarithmic singularity. We can define a metric on O delta such that we have this equation. Now, we have an inclusion U of delta in M cross M. And the differential, one way to define the differential actually, is just to say that this is the inverse image of O of minus delta. So we get a metric on omega m, such that this is an isometry. And the Arakelov norm on omega is simply u upper star of the norm on the diagonal. Okay, so this is a little long, but this is a metric which has nicer properties than others on the dualizing sheaf. U is the diagonal embedding. And here it's like U star, and here U star.
Is it a characterization when P is equal to Q?
P cannot be equal to Q because, again, it's repulsive. There is a logarithmic singularities. When P gets close to Q, this becomes like log ZP minus ZQ. So it blows up to minus infinity.
It seems like Green's function kind of.
That's
the Green function has singularities. So here, GP is L1 because log is L1. But it's not infinity.
It's a Green function.
So when P goes to Q, you're saying it catches some delta function?
Yes. The we have this equation here. The delta function comes in if we take the variation of the Green function. This is like Laplacian of the Green function and delta.
But when P is not equal to Q.
Yeah. When P is not equal to Q.
But when P equals to Q.
But there is no Q here. Which Q? You can evaluate GP of Q, but you cannot evaluate GPP.
And one function is defined as two null sets.
Yes. Okay. So now we are in a nice situation. We have exactly the notion we need to define arithmetic numbers. Namely, we have a line model and we have a metric on it.
And that's for an arbitrary Riemann surface.
For an arbitrary semi-stable curve.
Yeah. Wait, I have a question. It's a bit ad hoc definition. Is it analog of an Archimedean case? If you have curve of an Archimedean.
You can make an analogy between infinity and finite places, and the condition of the curve M will be analogous to the graph of components at finite places, and you can show that there is equation of this type on the graph. But here we, on the graph, on the scheme side, we don't consider the graph. Okay, so let omega bar be omega with the Arakelov metric, the Arakelov norm. Now we have a very interesting number, namely omega bar intersection omega bar, which is a real number. And remember the first part of the talk, we don't define it directly, namely we choose sections of omega here and omega here with divisors which meet properly. We don't take the same divisor for this copy of omega and this one. We consider divisors which meet properly. So we have a notion of self-intersection of omega bar. Okay. In 1981, Faltins proved that omega 2 is at least 0. And in 1997, Ullmo proved that omega 2 is strictly positive. So we could say it's why bother? But in fact, it's very interesting to go from at least 0 to strictly positive because of a result of Spiro. Spiro had proved that if we know that omega 2 is strictly positive, then we have a famous conjecture called the Bogomolov conjecture. It says the following. I consider the curve X, the generic fiber, the curve X over F bar, and I embed this in the Jacobian by choosing a point. Then we have the following property. There exists a positive real number epsilon such that the set of points of algebraic points in X such that the Néron-Tate height of P is less or equal to epsilon, this set is finite. So I will not define the Néron-Tate height, this is the height on the Jacobian, but here we prove from omega, Spiro proves that from the assertion that omega 2 is positive, one could deduce that in a small neighborhood of the zero section, there is no point. There is finitely many, so you can shrink till there is nothing. Before that, there was a result by Renault saying that if the height is zero, that is, if a point is torsion in the Jacobian, then there are finitely many points. So this Bogomolov is an effective version of Reynaud's theorem. And this comes from Arakelov intersection theory. So it's interesting to bound omega 2 from below, but it's also interesting to bound omega 2 from above. For this, I will introduce a notation, so I will call fq the degree of f over q. And delta f over q, the discriminant of f over q. So there is the following conjecture. Conjecture A, which is due to Parshin and is revisited in the paper I quoted, so due to Parshin and Moret-Bailly. Assume the genus of the generic fiber is at least 2. Then there is an upper bound of omega 2 of the form alpha log absolute value of delta plus beta times the degree of f over q. Alpha and beta are constant, and assume that in the conjecture, you assume that alpha and beta are what I will call bounded in projective families. What do I mean by this? Well, what happens is that this number here can be shown to depend only on the curve over f bar. And the claim is that when the curve over f bar is the fiber of a projective family over f bar, then alpha and beta remain bounded. So that's the conjecture of Parshin and Moret-Bailly. And in the paper I told you about, Moret-Bailly proves the following, so theorem 1, or theorem A, say, assume conjecture A holds, then there exist two constant A and B such that if A, B, C are non-zero integers of prime to each other, and such that A plus B equals C, then C is less or equal to A N to the B where N is a conductor, so N is a product over all prime dividing ABC of these primes, but no multiplicities. So N is a conductor. So the conjecture of Parshin and Moret-Bailly implies this form of the ABC conjecture, namely the constant C is bounded by A and some power of N. But the ABC conjecture is more precise than that. So the game I will play is to change conjecture A to conjecture B in such a way that you get actually the full ABC conjecture, the strongest form of ABC conjecture. So conjecture B let G equal 6, then for any positive epsilon, there exists a constant beta epsilon bounded in projective family. And we shall see later what really means projective families, because we will be interested in a very specific family. So there exists beta epsilon. What's the question?
More precise, if you just stop, for any B of epsilon, it's not a function of epsilon, it's secretly a function of something else, or just in bounded projective families. It's as a phrase, it doesn't make sense.
So at this point, we have X over F. A over OF, spec OF, a semi-stable curve. And once I have fixed it, there exists a constant beta epsilon, which remains bounded when X varies in a smooth family. And the genus is 6. It's only 6 which we count. We shall see in the proof. Okay, exists beta epsilon such that omega 2 is at most 3 over 2 plus epsilon log of the absolute value of the discriminant plus beta epsilon f over q, degree of f over q. So this is conjecture B. Fortunately, we have both conjectures on the backboard. You see conjecture B is a strengthening of conjecture A. Conjecture A, we have alpha and beta, and we just say that alpha and beta are bounded in families. Here, we have alpha equals 3 over 2 plus epsilon and beta bounded in families. So the fact that you specify the coefficient of log of the discriminant is the difference between conjecture A and conjecture B.
But it's special to the genus 6 case.
It will be used for curve of genus 6. We shall see them in the course.
But you could expect something for the genus
6? I have thought about this question. I don't know. I don't know how to phrase it for all genus. Okay. So theorem B. Says that the conjecture B implies that, well, for epsilon positive, exists a constant A of epsilon such that if ABC are non-negative integers with greatest common divisor 1 and such that A plus B equals C, then C is at most A epsilon n to the power 1 plus epsilon. So you have to compare theorem B and theorem A. Theorem B, theorem A, you have C less than A n to the B. And in theorem B, assuming conjecture B, you have an exponent which is 1 plus epsilon, which is the one which is traditionally given for the ABC conjecture. Okay. So in the starting next week, I will explain how one can prove that conjecture B implies theorem B. So since I have some time left, I will start with the proof. But maybe there are questions.
Proof of theorem A or B? A,
I omit. But I'm taking inspiration from Moret-Bailly paper, which is a proof that conjecture A implies theorem A. So I take his proof and adapt it to conjecture B to get theorem B. So our goal, again, is to prove theorem B. That is, we admit conjecture B and we try to prove ABC. So the first thing in the proof is a lemma. Which look as follows. So K is a number field. OK has integers in K. And let Y be a smooth proper variety of K. Assume I have given a model of Y so S is spec OK. So I will call it YS. Assume I'm giving a model of Y that is a proper flat morphism with generic fiber Y. And we consider the following. Assume that P is a point in Y. We call R the degree of f over q, of k over q. So everything is k. No, no. So f over k is a finite extension P is a point which coordinates in F, and R is the degree of F over Q. If I call T the spectrum of OF, P induces a morphism of schemes from T to IHES. This is by the evaluative criterion of properness. If I have a point on F, it extends to a point on T. Assume that for every F, every P, and U defined by P, we are given a real number, A of U. We write A of U less or equal to O of R when there is a constant such that A of U is less than AR. So, for every extension, for every point in the extension, we have this morphism U from the integers to IS, and assume we can define a real number, A of U. Here is U. So just a matter of notation, I say A of U is less than OR to mean that for all choices of the number field F and the point P, I have A of U less than constant times R. So this is just a notation. And now I assume that the dimension of Y is 1. I will introduce some Picard group, which is the following. Picard group of YS is the ring, the group spanned by L bar Hermitian line model on YS, and the operation tensor product. All this modulo isomorphism, which preserves the norm. As usual with line model, we have the Picard group, which is the group spanned by line models with operations of tensor product. Here we have a group spanned by Hermitian line model with tensor product, the operation. So assume given an element XS in peak hat of YS. I can also transcend with U the coefficients. So maybe a rational combination of Hermitian Lie model. Consider the restriction of IHES to the generic fiber. Why? So X is in PK group of Y tensor Q. On this group here, we have notion of degree, which is an algebraic notion, the degree on the curve Y. Excuse me, Q. Q. We can do something else, which is we can restrict XS to T. That is, as before, we have a map from T to YS by the variation of Catrian variation of properness. We can pull back the element XS on YS, we get an element in T, and T is dimension 1, so I can take its degree. So maybe I call it XT. And maybe I take a minus to make the statement nice. So this is a real number. So for every U, every point P, and every U from T to YS, I can pull back XS and get an element which has an arithmetic degree. So I get a real number. So this is the A of U, if you wish. And the lemma is the following. Lemma, assume the degree of X on the generic fiber. Degree of X is an algebraic notion which is defined on the top of this blackboard. Assume this degree is negative. Then, degree, what? Then XT is less or equal to O of R. So we postpone the proof to next time. But just to indicate what it means. It means I check a condition on the generic fiber on Y. And then for every point, I have this arithmetic notion XT, the degree when you pull back to the integers, and up to a constant, this degree is bounded. So this means that here you check something geometrically, and you reduce something arithmetic up to constant. So this will be useful.
What is R?
R is is F over Q. So XD is bounded by a constant of R. So we get some inequality for every point from a statement on the generic fiber. Okay, thank you.